And we're going to, let me tell you what I hope will happen. And I'm going to do a quick review of yesterday that'll just take a moment. So if you weren't here yesterday, it'll hopefully acquaint you with what we did. Then we're going to look at scripture that'll guide us into this second session. And I hope, I really genuinely hope that when we leave here today, we will have successfully equipped each other for some things that I think will help our churches. Let's begin with a prayer. Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you for last night, for all the things that have been happening in us and will be happening through us. I pray, Father, that this morning, that this session will be like a piece of glass through whom we see you and experience you. And we thank you for the opportunity to help each other grow. In the name of Jesus, amen. So the theme of this three-part class is a coup for the kingdom. And what I'm trying to relate to specifically is that oftentimes we imagine a coup like some kind of a visual military takeover. But what I'm more referring to is a phrase that I shared with you yesterday, ideological colonization. This is the invasion of thought that disrupts the order of the kingdom of God. And so yesterday, we started with Jesus versus the Bible. And I know that sounds strange, but what we're specifically referring to is that the Bible is in submission to the voice who gave it. So the work of Scripture is the work of the King who gave the Scripture. We talked yesterday about in Scripture we find prescriptive and descriptive. And so the prescriptive is how things ought to be. The descriptive is how things are. And it takes discernment and maturity to work through those. Secondly, we talked about character and catechism. Most of us are familiar with the fact that in our Christian movement, and I mean of many stripes, the willingness to agree to a catechism, you know what I mean by that? The willingness to agree to a set of doctrines was actually how we were either accepted or rejected from a fellowship of believers. Character was another story. We could be immovable on the catechism. You believe it or you're out. You believe it or you don't teach, right? You believe it or you don't serve. You believe it or you don't teach ladies' Bible class. You believe it or you're not an elder. You know, that kind of thing. But character could be all over the map. And I learned this early on when I realized in one of the churches that we served in that a guy that was being put forth to be an elder was an obvious racist. And I actually had a conversation face-to-face with him because I felt like that's what was right to do. This is what Jesus teaches us. A couple of other elders with me. We got through it, and he was kind of wishy-washy on his racism, but he was still in the running to be an elder. So what I realized was he was doctrinally, as far as the catechism of the church was acceptable, but character-wise, there was a lot of latitude. And the things that we were seeing in him were not birthed from Jesus Christ, but we were still thinking about him being an elder in Jesus' church. And that just seemed strange to me, okay? So what I recognized was any time that the catechism that we draw from Scripture becomes more important than the character that Christ is building within us, we've had a coup for the kingdom. Number three, love is Jesus' doctrine. I know who I'm with this morning, my family, and I know this seems like such a no-brainer. It's like, well, why are we even talking about it? But here's what I've discovered. I've been preaching for 34 years. Here's what I have discovered. We think that love is like doctrine light, like Coca-Cola light. Like those of you that have traveled, you know, they don't call it Diet Pepsi. It's Coke or Diet Coke. It's Coca-Cola light or whatever. It's like light beer. It's like, it's not the real doctrine. It's kind of the fuzzy stuff that these grace-oriented Pepperdine goers get. You know, that's what they want, right? It is crazy to me. When Jesus says, oh, no. This is my doctrine. A new command I give you, right? I mean, how much clearer does Jesus have to be to get his doctrine and we still don't buy it? And you know You know the church struggles with this one point, that it is his doctrine. So this morning, we are going to move into the next part, Jesus versus the church. And I think this is a natural progression, that if we have so honored Scripture that it takes a greater role, our interpretation of it takes a greater role than Christ himself, then you knew this was coming, that the church can do the same thing. So let's look at our foundational text, Matthew 4:17. From that time on, Jesus began to preach, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." Now just think with me for a moment. Kingdom means the reign of God. Jesus said, of all the vocabulary of angels and earth, I've got to tell you, the only word that comes to my mind when you hit the kingdom is the word repent. You will have to change the way you think and feel about life. When you meet the king, it will change everything. In fact, the template for this is the Apostle Paul on the road to Damascus. He meets Jesus. And his first question is, who are you? And the first thing Jesus tells him is what he's got to do. So when you meet Jesus, you will spend the rest of your life asking, who have I met? That's getting to know him. And what does he want from my life? This is the walk of a believer. So now let's look at the church, and we'll begin in Ephesians 2. I'm going to be reading two sections of Ephesians 2 and chapters 2 and then 3. So let's look at verses 13 through 22. Therefore, remember that formerly you who are Gentiles by birth, and you're called under this framework of uncircumcised, meaning, of course, those who call themselves a circumcision, which is done in the body by human hands. So the people that were brought into the covenant at birth and had circumcision as a form or a way of designating them, those of you that didn't have that, you were separate. So remember that at that time, you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel, and foreigners to the covenant of the promise. You were without hope and without God in the world. But now, in Christ, you who were one, or who were once far away, have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made the two groups one. He's destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility, by setting aside in his flesh the law with its commands and regulations. His purpose was to create in himself one new humanity out of the two, thus making peace, and in one body to reconcile both of them to God through the cross by which he put to death their hostility. He came and preached peace to you who are far away, and peace to those who are near. For through him we both have access by the Father, to the Father by one Spirit. So consequently, you are no longer foreigners or strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people and also members of his household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. In him, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in him, you too are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit. So here's the question of this session. What is the purpose of the church? What is the purpose of the church? Now, I want to remind you what N.T. Wright said the other night. If you treat one part of the truth as the whole, it becomes an untruth. Now, how do I know this? So I was converted in college. We were fired up evangelistically. One of the guys that was instrumental in leading me to faith, he asked me to go on a mission trip. I said, I haven't been baptized yet. He said, go with us anyway. You'll know a lot more about the cost of following Jesus after a mission trip. That's what it was like in college, right? We had one page, and from that one page, we could convert the world. Blood of Jesus, bridge across the chasm. How many of you remember that one page? We could convert the world with that one page. So somebody asks you, what's the purpose of the church? It's the purpose of Jesus Christ, Luke 19:10, right? We had this in our mind. The problem was that we had fallen into the trap that Brother Wright said the other night, and that is that if you got one part of the truth and you're treating it like the whole, it becomes an untruth. Look back at what Paul said in Ephesians. Look at this. His purpose. This is God's purpose. What was our question? What is the purpose of the church? This is an incredibly helpful answer. His purpose was to create in himself one new humanity. So somebody asks you, what's the purpose of the church? Well, according to God, it's to create in himself one new humanity. What? Don't talk to me in those theological terms. Talk to me, you know, right, in practical terms. We need to seek and save the lost. Right? And God says, is there any way we could have coffee? Where you could slow down and you could ask me what's the purpose of the church and I could tell you and you would believe me. So let's practice. So God says, let's practice. You say to me, Father, what is the purpose of your church? Father, what is the purpose of your church? And then I say to you, my purpose was to create in myself one new humanity. That was my purpose. What? Yeah, oh, and let me explain a little bit more. And in one body, I will reconcile them both to me. What? Lord, I don't think you remember the scriptures. You know, go into all the world and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. You said that. Do you not remember that? God says, I do. Do you remember the whole thing? Teaching them to observe everything I taught you. So I taught you how to participate in the redemption of this broken world so that we would create a body in which my purposes would be fulfilled. And my purpose is to create one new humanity. How many of you think that it might be tough to find a cross-section of Christians in our churches to where this would be the first answer they gave if we asked them, what's the purpose of the church? I'm serious. You feel what I'm saying? I think you would admit this might not be the first scripture they'd run to, right? Well, let's take it a step further. I told you we'd go to Ephesians 3. Let's do that now. This mystery is that through the gospel, the Gentiles are heirs together with Israel, members together of one body, and sharers together in the promise of Christ Jesus. Paul says, I became a servant of this gospel by the gift of God's grace given me through the working of his power. Although I am I'm less than the least of all the Lord's people, this grace was given to me to preach to the Gentiles the boundless riches of Christ and to make plain to everyone the administration of this mystery, which for ages past was hidden in God who created all things, his intent. Does that sound a little bit like purpose? His intent was that now, through the church, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known to the rulers and the authorities in the heavenly realms according to his eternal purpose that he accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord. In him and through faith in him, we may approach God with freedom and confidence. So I ask you, therefore, not to be discouraged because of my sufferings for you, which are for your glory. So as we bring these first two sessions together, I want to put them together in one statement, and we'll have it on the screen. just as Scripture is in submission to the voice that gave it, so also the church is in submission to the one who gave it life. So Scripture submits to the voice that gave it. It is Scripture's role to support God's intent. So it is the church's role to support God's intent. Otherwise, it's a coup for the kingdom. If the church starts calling the shots, we're in trouble. So what role did God imagine for the church in his plan? What role did God imagine for the church in his plan? If his purpose was to create one new humanity, what role does the church play in that? Well, let's look at this. Okay. When you think about the way that the church of Christ is described in Scripture, right? So we have this church. It's birthed out of the work of Christ, right? Right? So what's the role? Well, think about it this way. So he refers to it as like a sheep and flock, right? So do you remember in John chapter 10, Jesus says, I have other sheep that are not of this sheep pen. So I've got to go get them, and there will be one flock, and there will be one shepherd. Remember this? So he's talking to Jews, talking about what? Gentiles. He said, I've got to go out and get them, because we're going to end up with what? One flock and one shepherd, and I've got to go do this, right? He talks about it in terms of a temple, and this goes back and forth between his body as a temple and the church, his body, as a temple. So the temple is the place where God brings his children together. We are the image bearers of God's image, and we come together to worship the God that this temple points toward. We are the synagogue and the ecclesia. This is interesting. You remember James, when he talks about the church, you know, he's a Jewish guy, he uses the term synagoge. He calls the church the synagogue of God, okay? So synagogue means what? The bringing together, the joining together. It's like ecclesia. It's kind of the similar idea. So there's this idea that there's this calling that happens. And as the voice of God calls throughout the earth, people respond to the call of God. And as we mentioned yesterday in Acts chapter 2, the miracle of Pentecost is not the miracle of tongues, or excuse me, the miracle of fire. It's the miracle of nations. What shocks them is not that someone speaking in tongues. What shocks them is they all hear in their own dialect. That was God's way of saying, I am calling humanity from its diaspora of brokenness into the oneness of the new humanity. It's called a field, a building, a net. It's called a kingdom. And so the first four letters of that word should indicate that since we already have a king, we're working on the second part of the word. And that is the gathering of the flock to the king. The other night, N.T. Wright made this observation. As God finished his work on Friday and rested on the seventh day, Easter was the first day of God's new creation. Well, what did he say back in Ephesians 3, 15 and 16? Let's look at it again. His purpose was to create. So God was creating again. Creating in himself one new humanity. So the story of creation, our foundational story, right? That in the beginning, say it with me, God created. So what did he do at the resurrection of Jesus? He created again. And what did he create? One new humanity. So now I have some questions that I think will help us apply this. Number one, what responsibility does the church have to the world? What is our responsibility to the world? Well, because for the sake of time, I'm going to try to nudge us a little bit, okay? If God's intent was to create one new humanity, our responsibility in the world is to model the new humanity. It's to model the new humanity. So our goal is not to get people to heaven. I think that would be fruitless anyway, since God is the only one that could do that. But the part we can do is fulfill his purpose and his intent. And that is through the church to make known to the principalities and power that a new humanity has been created, and all who are called from the diaspora of brokenness come together to recreate with God the new humanity. So, question: how does the life of Jesus guide the life of the church? Well, what was he doing? He was creating the new humanity. Okay, so real quickly, we're going to have to move through this part pretty quickly, but we're going to can we put that back on the screen just for a moment? How does the life of Christ, life of Jesus guide the life of the church? So I want to work on this real quickly. I'm going to just need you to really stay with me on this. When Jesus came into the world, right? He's the incarnation of God, right? The Word became flesh and dwelled among us, right? And we beheld his glory as one begotten from the Father, full of grace and truth, right? Let me process this with you real quickly. If you read the extended nativity scene from Luke chapter 1 through Luke 2, and you also read the account in Matthew, you would find an interesting scenario. You would find that God brought together the new humanity around the manger. This is kind of exciting. Are you ready for this? So think about John the Baptist's parents. You have a white-collar, older couple, both from a priestly tribe, you know, haven't been able to have kids. Everybody knows they wanted kids, couldn't have kids, right? And so they end up having this kid, and everybody's all excited about this boy's going to be born. So you got this older, white-collar couple that is really excited about having a baby. And then you got Joseph and Mary, which is kind of the opposite. You got these young kids, you got a weird story that who in the world is going to believe this story? But an embarrassing thing has happened, and this girl is pregnant, and she's saying God did it to her, and it's a weird story. But they also are a blue-collar couple, right? They're poor. When they finally do have the kid, they can't offer a lamb because they don't have money, but the law allowed for that, you know, to have for poor people to, you know, give a turtle dove, and so that kind of marks them economically, right? And then you've got the shepherds, which clearly would be the no color, right? You've got the shepherds out in the field, but they're brought into the mix. And then you've got this widow, Anna, you remember her, this older widow. She's in her 80s and a godly older lady. But you've got these Persian guys that come over, and they are so loaded with money that when they arrive, they can dump off gold, frankincense, and myrrh and still have plenty of money to go home. And those of you that are economists in here and that's your business is money, you might remember this. Twice in the history of Egypt, myrrh actually traded for more than gold. Very expensive. So these guys are just loaded with money. Right? So they all end up around the birth story of Jesus. So what do we have here? Well, we have economic diversity. White collar, blue collar, no collar. We have family structure diversity. Widow, young couple, old couple. We have, obviously, the most obvious skin color with the Persian guys coming over. We got academic diversity because you got, you know, John the Baptist's parents, and you got these astronomers that come over from Persia, and then you got these shepherds sitting here. I wonder if God wanted to say right from his very first peep out of the incarnated mouth of baby Jesus, people, this is what I'm here to do, is to create a new humanity. So we should not be surprised that in the ministry of Jesus, he had to go through Samaria. That should not surprise us, right? It shouldn't surprise us that he makes Samaritans the heroes of stories, which was really kind of crazy, wasn't it? It shouldn't surprise us that he has encounters with Syrophoenician women, has encounters with Samaritan women. This should not surprise us one bit, nor should it surprise us that the apostles had to make sure that the Grecian widows were taken care of and not overlooked in the feeding of the widows. Nor should it surprise us that the Samaritans get saved, that the Gentiles get saved, that the Africans get saved in Acts 6, 8, and 10. None of this should surprise us, right? Because from birth, what was God doing? Do you realize that none of the people around his birth were walk-ons? He called them by angels, the Holy Spirit, dreams, and a star. God made sure that the picture of the new humanity was present in the first nativity. And we are called to be the church of that nativity. One new humanity. So the life of Jesus guides the life of the church. I came to this question for myself. Is the church preparing individuals for heaven or preparing and proclaiming the restored community of God? See, I've noticed in my many years, and I participated in it. This is not a judgment. This is me confessing. We would get so excited about the midnight baptisms. You know, we'd call everybody. You guys probably been a part of this craziness, you know. Call everybody, so-and-so is getting baptized tonight, you know. Run up there to the church. I remember one night we ran up. Our baptistry had a leak in it. So we called a preacher from another town. Hey, man, can we come over? Yeah, you know, and they showed up. So they didn't even know us. They showed up. We're all hooping and hollering, thrilled that another soul is baptized into Christ. I got to tell you, that's still exciting. But that's about like never leaving the OB ward at a hospital. And the reason that many of our churches are plagued with immaturity is because we missed the component of proclaiming and celebrating the new humanity. So that when a brother or sister shed the burden of greeting us, we cheered like we cheered at their baptism. When the scales fell off and someone finally let go of their racism, and we cheered like we cheered at their baptism. But you understand what happened to us. We got locked into thinking that the role of the church is getting the next person individually to heaven. So I've actually had people ask me throughout my ministry, do you think I'm saved? I'm scared. Let me tell you about my baptism. I just got an email yesterday, someone describing their baptism. Their question was, do you think it was valid? You know what their concern is? Am I going to heaven? The very first person that I ever watched die, Lewis Penn, wonderful man of God, lived up in Byesville, Ohio, wonderful man of God, in his 70s, in his hospital bed, faithful Christian his whole life, scared to death to die. Not scared of dying, scared of death, wondering if he was saved. You see what we propagated? What we propagated inadvertently was the most important thing that'll ever happen in your life is that you will seal your ticket to go to heaven. Once that's done, then we forget that we're here to proclaim to the principalities what was God's intent, the creation of a new humanity. Once again, if you treat one part of the truth as the whole, it becomes an untruth. So now maybe what we should drift toward as we kind of aim toward the application of this, are individual Christians accountable for the life of the church? You You see, we think about the church institutionally, and we'll ask questions like, where is the church headed? I don't know what's happening to the church. I fear for the church. Have you heard any of this in your assembly, the church you go to, right? Okay. Well, my question is, are you individually accountable for the life of the church? To proclaim the new humanity. Last night, Ruby Bridges said something that absolutely struck me to the core, and I have not been able to shake it. If you make yourself available to evil, evil will use you. You remember her saying that last night? Here's what struck me. Some of the things that we regret the most in this group that I gathered this morning is we regret the individual actions of Christians that we know. We regret this. So we'll hear a Christian say something that is absolutely horrible, or they'll post something on Facebook, absolutely horrible, and it just makes us cringe when that happens, right? And you've felt this, haven't you? Someone will say something at church, say something in a small group, say something at a Bible study, say something at a Bible class. Have you seen this happen? And it just makes you cringe. Well, I think part of the problem is that people are not seeing themselves once they and are immersed into the King. They're not seeing the life of the King lived out in the new humanity through them. So how would you answer this question? Are individual Christians accountable for the life of the church? How would you answer that question? How would you answer it up here? Yes, right? It's kind of a no-brainer, right? But how would we answer it when it comes to the hands and the feet and the mouth and so on, right? It's a little harder, isn't it? Wouldn't you agree? So here's what I think we could do. If you'll write down these three components, this made a big difference to us in how we assess our church at home, and I think it'll help you. Number one of the things that we notice in the life of Jesus Christ is hospitality. This word in the original language of our Bibles means to love strangers. Philios xenia, love strangers. So hospitality means loving the people that are not like you. Now think about the potential of that to build the new humanity. That's pretty exciting, isn't it? Do you realize that for generations, even church growth experts suggested that crossing ethnicity and cultural barriers was not a prerequisite of faithfulness to the gospel? Did you know that? That was written in some of the preeminent missionary and missional training books. That crossing ethnicity and cultural barriers was not a prerequisite of faithfulness to the gospel. I've got a question for you. How in the world would you square that theory with what we read in Ephesians 2 and 3? I mean, how do you even, those two are diametrically opposed. Because if we're creating one new humanity, and that's the purpose of the church, I think individually I better get to work on that. I better figure out how to do that. So I need to figure out how to get people into my life and to be a part of someone else's life, of people that are not like me, at least in the ways that Ruby described last night. They're not like me in the exterior ways. Now, of course, what I might find out is once we get to know each other, we might be very much alike, correct? Do you think that the church could be the headlights on this project in America? You follow what I'm saying about that? That the church could be the headlights on this project in America? Wouldn't it be something if somebody could get going on this in America, where we would be creating a new humanity out of the broken diaspora of our culture? Wouldn't that be something? Wouldn't that be amazing? Can you imagine the possibilities of something like that? One of my friends, Dr. Ken Green, that lives in Dallas, he knows our family and knows me. And one of the things that he mentioned is he said, one of the things you need to be thinking about, because we have a son that's African-American. He said, when you're raising him, one of the things you got to pay attention to is you're used to walking in a room and seeing people that look like you. He's not used to that. So when he walks into a room, he's going to scan that room. It is just within his DNA. He's going to scan that room to look for anyone that looks like him. Well, he told me this. We were in Fort Worth at a conference. Our two sons that are the same age, Aaron and Jerome, were both students at ACU. They were going to come and spend the weekend with me since I was going to be in Fort Worth. So I'm watching out the window of this conference, and I see them drive up in their Jeep. I go out to meet them. They surprise me. They both pray over me. It's a really emotional moment. We come walking up. We're ready to walk in, and our son Aaron, I tell him, hey, Dr. Green's in there. I watch our son Aaron walk up to the door at a room. He just walked straight in. I was standing behind Jerome. I watched him walk up to the door. He just walked. He didn't know I was watching. Walked up to the door and just went like this. And spotted Dr. Green, the only other African American in the room. He was answering a question. The question wasn't, is there anyone else here like me? The question was, is there a place for someone like me among you? And in the new humanity, we need to resoundingly answer that question. It needs to be crystal clear that among the people of God, we don't sit back and say, well, the door is always open. We evaluate why the door is open and people aren't coming through it. We do not sit back as the people of God and wait for the world to create the new humanity. We are in the business of co-creating the new humanity with God. And if you think your door is open, but people aren't coming through it, you need to get out of that door and go figure out why people don't feel like they can be at home in your place. That is just the end game. After our kids left home, my wife still had a lot of Thanksgiving left in her. And so she started this thing for Thanksgiving called Arrive as Strangers, Leave as Friends. Everybody that would come to our house for Thanksgiving, we'd have two Thanksgivings, one on Thursday, one on Friday. And the one on Thursday was this Arrive as Strangers, Leave as Friends. And everybody knew, we knew them all, but they didn't know each other. Right? So we'd get out, gather, you know, a dozen or 15 people together, gather them around the table, and we'd have a Thanksgiving dinner together. So these people, they are from the diaspora of the broken humanity. So they're wrapped in different experiences and economics and education and colors and all kinds of different things going on in their lives. And I'm watching them, and their skin is crawling. They agreed to come because we asked them, but they're scared to death sitting at the table. Until we say, hey, why don't y'all go around and introduce yourself? And pretty soon, the new humanity, the seeds of the new humanity are planted. I looked across the table. Somebody thought, well, I'm the only one that doesn't belong here. You know, I'm a lesbian woman. I'm the only one that doesn't belong here. But I'm also a lesbian woman whose brother died, and I'm struggling with alcoholism, and the guy four seats down from me shares, he's not gay, but he shares that his brother passed away, and he's in AA. So now I discover that there's something about me that means that I can be a part of what? This. Those are the seeds of the new humanity. Now, think about Jesus stopping at the well, arrive as strangers, leave as friends, right? You remember that story of Jesus going to the woman in Samaria? He sits down at the well, and what is the first thing that lady says? You do not belong here. You remember that? And you remember John, the apostle says, and by the way, Samaritans and Jews, they don't get along. Why did he write that in there? Because his gospel went to people that didn't know that backstory. Jesus said, honey, if you knew who I was, you'd realize that there's a lot of opportunity for something special to happen here. Isn't that what he said? and the seeds of the new humanity were planted. Hospitality. Number two is access. Access. Do you create a situation where people feel like they have access to you? Can they get into your world? Is your world an easy world to join? Now I'll illustrate this. So a guy, an older guy comes to me. He says, "You got any time for breakfast this week?" And I said, "Sure. You know, I'd be glad to. What days you got open?" He said, "I'm retired. I got every day open, you know." So I said, "All right, you know." So we get together for breakfast. We get on it for breakfast. He said, I need some help on something." I said, "Well, tell me about it." He said, "Well, I went out to visit my daughter last week, and we had a terrible situation. I've really messed up." And I said, "Well, what happened?" And he said, "Well, we got into this conversation, and she was talking about a friend of hers that was having a hard time. I figured out partway through the conversation that her friend was gay, and I said to her, 'Well, just to make it clear, they know gay Christians.'" Okay. "Well," he said, "and now she won't talk to me." I said, "Does it bother you that she won't talk to you?" "Well, of course, that's why I asked you for breakfast." "Okay, so it bothers you that your daughter won't talk to you. Why does it bother you that your daughter won't talk to you?" "Well, I love my daughter." "Well, I know that, but what else?" "I want my daughter to love me." "Well, I think your daughter does love you. I think you love your daughter and your daughter loves you. I think you're good on that." "Well, yeah, but she won't talk to me." "Well, she's not talking to you because she doesn't love you. And she's not talking to you not because you don't love her. She's not talking to you because you told her not to." "What do you mean?" "Well, you told her not to. She brought up something to talk about. You responded to her in such a way that said, 'Don't talk to me about that.' And so she isn't talking to you." "Oh, well, how do I make this right?" I said, "Well, why don't you go back, tell her you're sorry, and say, 'You know, I didn't listen very well. Could you tell me more?'" "What else?" "I would start with that." Because you see, what you did is you said, "I don't have the maturity and the emotional bandwidth to listen to a conversation that makes me uncomfortable, so I shut them down." That's what I do. I don't have the maturity or the emotional bandwidth. You follow what I mean by bandwidth, right? I don't have enough. So when you bring up certain topics, I have to kill that conversation because I'm afraid the conversation will kill me. So I have to stop it somehow. I can rant and rave. I can climb all over you. I can shut you down. If it happens on Facebook, I can blow up all over you on Facebook. Whatever I can do, but I've got to somehow stop you from talking about something because I don't have the emotional maturity and the bandwidth to listen to something that makes me feel uncomfortable. Now, some of you are thinking, "Yes, I do. I've had to listen to a lot of uncomfortable things in life." Well, then just start doing it and it's going to get better. Just start doing it, it's going to get better. You say, "Well, what do you mean by that?" Well, let's move to the third one. Let's start having conversations. Let's start having really good conversations, okay? So somebody says, "Well, what do you think about this whole Supreme Court thing from last June 26th? And you could start off with, "Oh, I can't believe what our country's coming to." Or you could start off with something like, tell me what you think. Now, which of those do you think would kind of keep the conversation rolling? And which of those do you think will help you plant seeds of the new humanity? Right? You see, that's not like brain surgery, right? You understand that if I'm learning this, you are way ahead. You can do this. So you just say, "Well, just tell me about it." "Well, I think it's the greatest thing in the world. You know, it's a democracy and it's a constitutional democracy. I think it's the greatest thing in the world." You say, "Well, it had to be important for you to bring it up to me today. Tell me a little bit more about that." And you get to the end of that and tell me a little bit more. And then they say, "Well, what do you think?" And you say, "You know what? You've given me a lot to think about today. I think I'll go chew on it and why don't we get together later?" Why not? What you're doing, if you're doing the other one, isn't working. Well, I think it's the dumbest thing in the world. It's not working.
He's crazy.
That's not working either.
He's an apostate. That's not working. They don't even load the Bible anymore.
That's not working. None of this is working to build the new humanity. In fact, it's the exact opposite. When we respond like that, we're doing the enemy's work for him. We're continuing the brokenness of humanity. We're not participating in the creation of a new humanity. We're participating in the ongoing destruction of the new humanity. Agreed? You follow where I'm coming from? Okay, now I'm going to make a quick confession. I'm just going to put it out there. When my wife and I were watching the interview when President Clinton and the whole Monica Lewinsky thing was unfolding, my wife and I were watching the interview. I wasn't a big Clinton fan anyway. We'd lived in Arkansas, and I just wasn't a big Clinton fan. Who knows why? But don't judge me on that. I just wasn't. I'm confessing. Act like a priest. I'm confessing. Okay. So, but I do remember thinking, don't do it. Don't do it. I was thinking Nixon. That tells you how old I am. I'm thinking Nixon. Don't do it. Just tell him the truth. And what did he do? Didn't tell the truth. Big mess. So, you know, in my awesome Christian spirit, I said, I no longer have a president. Boy, that's mature, stunningly mature. But I'm being transparent with you, okay? Ah, but when Bush came into office, Bush Part Two, and I started hearing people call him things like idiot, fool, stupid, I thought, oh, good grief. That's what I sounded like when I did that. What is the matter with me? What is the matter with me? Now, you understand, I had a lot of friends, especially veterans, who did not agree with Bush invading Iraq and things like that, and that's all policy issues and so on, okay? So that's not what I'm referring to, okay? I'm not talking about Clinton or Bush. I'm talking about Don McLaughlin, realizing that by the way I would talk about people in public discourse, I was either adding to the destruction of the humanity, or I could contribute to planting the seeds of the new humanity. You follow where I'm coming from on that? So, in this present context, have you noticed it's a little bit emotional? Have you noticed in church it can get emotional? Have you noticed this? So here's my question. Are you personally accountable to God's purpose for the church to create the new humanity? So someone said, I can't believe you can't see the good in Donald Trump. If your response is to check them into a mental ward, what if you just changed that and said, tell me more? And I don't mean with loaded weapon to blast the fire out of them. I just mean to have a conversation and find out what's going on in your brother or sister in Christ. And if someone says, well, I think you're just a complete idiot if you can't vote for Hillary, and you're thinking to yourself, well, I think you're a complete idiot if you do. You understand that's not the new humanity. So how would we plant the seeds of the new humanity? Well, he said he was trying to build what? One new humanity, right? So if we're trying to build one new, we better stay in touch with each other and figure out how to do that really well. Right? So someone says what they're going to do politically, tell me more. I'm just so frustrated with what's going on in our world, in our nation racially. And so-and-so's to blame for it, and so-and-so's to blame for it, and so-and-so's to blame for it. Real quickly, how have those conversations gone for you so far? Have they built the new humanity? Yes, no, or maybe. Just shake your head yes, no, or maybe. Let me know at least that you're working on this. It has not been overly effective, right? Would you agree? So if it's not working to build the new humanity, you realize that we're actually working against the purpose of God for his church. That's kind of weird, isn't it? that the people of God would work against the, well, that's called a coup for the kingdom. So if we're going to reverse that, then we would say something like, somebody says, well, I'm really struggling with this, 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 and somebody says, like you, tell me more. I want to hear more. I know that's become important to you, and I want to participate in life with you. The purpose of the kingdom of God is to create a new humanity, and we are accountable individually to that purpose. God bless you. I hope to see you tomorrow.